Yeah, so today I will talk about the Gnosis Safe. I will essentially talk just about one smart contract. We have been working on this contract for over 1 year now, but the implications of this one smart contract are hopefully quite significant for the Ethereum development and the user experience. So, first question to ask, like, why are we actually building yet another wallet? There are already so many wallets out there, and I guess many of you have installed maybe even a couple of them. So why do we put so much effort into this? And the reason is that we are significantly different from all of them because we are the first smart contract-based wallet for mobile. We try to make smart contract-based wallet accessible for everyone as a default way to interact on the Ethereum network. So what are the implications of using a smart contract? Let's look into like how are all the other wallets currently interacting. They're using the account model where you have externally owned accounts, which are controlled by a private key that users hold, and then you are signing Ethereum transactions with this private key, and then the transactions are broadcasted and mined. What is the issue with just using this externally owned account as your account on Ethereum? There are mainly two issues with this. One is you have to have proper backups of this private key. If you're losing the private key, you lose access to your account. And the other thing is, yeah, there might be also benefits to that. Like you can ensure that no one will be ever able to access this again. But for the most part, people will be quite frightened if they see, oh, I lost my private key. And this happens quite a lot if you talk to all the wallet providers which are using externally owned accounts. There are quite a lot of issues popping up with, oh, I lost my password or I lost my backup. Can you help me restoring my account? No, sorry, we can't. You just lost everything. So that's still an unsolved issue today. And smart contracts are a way we can try to tackle this, and I'll explain to you in a minute why. So another thing is we have not really any way to have proper access control. If you have a private key, yes, you can access just everything. So imagine the future. Of course, your private key is not only your key to access your funds, but of course, it's also representing you on different dApps. Social networks will be used as dApps, and you are represented always with your private key. If you're losing it, you lose everything. You lose kind of your digital identity. And yeah, another thing is also, you are not able with a private key to do fine-grained access control. You could never do something like what you can do today with your credit card, where you say, ah, I am okay with just withdrawing a certain amount of money on a daily basis. But if I want to withdraw more, then I have to have additional security measures in place. So the future is contract accounts, that's what we are doing. And the good thing about contracts is you can implement all kind of logic, obviously, into those contracts. And this is because contracts are so-called first-class citizens in Ethereum, meaning they can perform the same operations on the Ethereum network as an externally owned account, as a private key-controlled account. So let's just look at how this actually works. Yeah? On the top, the externally owned account, you just sign your Ethereum transaction. That's it. That's what we do all the time. But the more interesting part is contract account interaction. What you do is you are signing something called a meta transaction. Yeah, so you're signing a transaction which will be executed from the wallet contract account, from the proxy contract account. Yeah? And of course, this meta transaction still has to be broadcasted to the Ethereum network and still someone has to sign this. But this doesn't necessarily have to be the same entity as the entity signing the meta transaction. So let's look into meta transactions. How do they actually work? So if we are sending this meta transaction wrapped into a regular Ethereum transaction, then it will trigger an execution on the wallet contract. And the first thing we have to do is we have to ensure that this meta transaction was signed by a party that is allowed to trigger this transaction from the contract. So what we have to do is we have to validate the signatures which were sent along with the meta transaction. And the standard way of how we implement access control on the nodes is safe is by just implementing a regular multi-signature wallet. So n out of m of those signatures that you are providing in your meta transactions have to be from valid owners of this contract to allow execution of the meta transaction from the contract. And what we allow is two different types of signatures. One is something that we call contract signatures. Usually smart contracts, well, they don't own a private key, so they don't cannot sign anything, but what you can essentially do is you can require that this function will call an external contract and ask if this contract gives permission to execute the meta transaction. So what this essentially means is that you can have different safe contracts being owners of other safe contracts. So you can have nested safes where some safes are owners of other safes. This might be interesting if you want to build organizations. We have different departments with different employees, and they should authenticate specific transactions, and then they can be part of another multisig, which is an overarching multisig to govern a bigger part of the organization. The other signatures that we allow is just regular ECDSA signatures. Those signatures are just the regular signatures that you have on Ethereum, simple private key controlled accounts. So the next step is, of course, just executing the meta transaction. And what the Gnosis Safe allows you to do is it allows you to do all the operations that you can also do with an externally owned account. Like previous multisigs, they usually were limited to doing call operations, meaning they do an internal transaction to another contract. What we also allow to do is to directly create a contract, for example, from the new multisig, or to execute something called delegate call, meaning you can actually extend the functionality of the safe for the period of this transaction execution to embed new logic during the execution call. The third part, and that's probably one of the most interesting improvements, is that within the meta transaction execution, we allow to send a refund to the party who was submitting the transaction. And what are the implications of that? So previously, when you had a multisig contract and you had owners which had to sign, commit to, let's go back to the previous Gnosis multisig that you may know. You had different accounts which were sending transactions to confirm transactions, and they all had to be funded with Ether. Now, because we have the meta transactions, you just collect those signed messages, they are sent, and then you still had to, in order to send this Ethereum transaction, you still had to sign the Ethereum transactions, which has to be signed by an account that holds Ether, in order to incentivize miners to actually mine this transaction. Now, what we can do is, we can define the meta transaction that we refund whoever is sending whoever's signing the Ethereum transaction, which is sending the meta transaction to the contract, to refund. Yeah? And we can do this in two ways. We can refund in Ether, or we can refund in any ERC20 token. And so this is kind of like an overview of how it works. So we have the meta transaction that is signed by anyone who is owning the wallet contract account. And then someone has to send those meta transactions to this contract in an Ethereum transaction. And this Ethereum transaction has to be signed by someone. And this has to be signed by an account usually which has Ether, so we can incentivize miners to mine this transaction. And there's currently a group working on relayers where we can send those meta transactions to, which will then actually sign the Ethereum transaction to broadcast the meta transaction to the Ethereum network and actually make the transaction happening. In the future, we might see that meta transactions will be mined or will be directly mined by miners, So having those relayers is just an intermediary solution. Yeah, you just have to have someone with an account that has Ether on it to send this transaction. But essentially, if miners would be able to merge the pending transactions that we have on Ethereum today with meta transactions that are pending, they could actually just sign those, and not even having to require, and would not even need Ether in order to process them, because they are the miner who are actually mining this block, so they can just include those transactions. The implication of this is that you actually remove kind of like this one very concrete use case for Ether itself, because today the value of Ether, or the reason why we have Ether is, and why Ether is used, is because it's the easiest way to bribe miners to mine your transaction. Theoretically, you could try to send them money with PayPal, but that's just not feasible. So now, because users can just say, okay, I will refund the miner with my ERC20 token, actually, Ether itself is not really required for this anymore. So what are other like implications of using smart contract accounts that have a significant impact on our dApps? Something that we can allow is batch transactions. So what we can do is we can, instead of signing one transaction after the other and broadcasting to the network, we can now combine transactions together and send them as one Ethereum transaction. So here what we do is basically, we pass all transactions as one byte array, and then we have to parse it and then execute all the single transactions. And there are a couple of advantages of doing this. One is it improves usability. Like today, if you're using a dApp, then usually the interaction workflow involves at least two transactions. One is you have to, for example, approve a token to a contract, and then you do another transaction to actually call the contract and use the token for whatever the contract should be doing. Now we can combine all of them together and execute them at once. So the user knows the whole business process is executed, or not a single step of this business process. Another advantage is that it also reduces gas costs. So in Ethereum, for every single Ethereum transaction, you have to pay 21,000 gas as fixed costs. If you combine them, then you have this cost only one time. Third advantage is that it allows you to have automaticity of transactions. So for example, if you would like to do an arbitrage trade between different exchanges, you would like to have all transactions executed or none of them. That's only possible with such kind of concept. So we talked about access control. The default way to control access in the node safe is a regular multisig, but we'll also allow to implement and extend the access control using modules. And modules are basically like additional contracts which have to be whitelisted in the multisig in order to execute transactions from the multisig. And one very interesting module that we envision will have significant impact is, of course, recovery of the account, recovery of the multisig itself. So how could a recovery module look like? So here we do something that initially was, I think, invented by Uport. It's called social recovery. The idea is that you have you have a group of friends, and if they collide and agree that you lost access to your account, then they allow you to change one of the owners of your account. And yeah, that's what we do here, basically. So first we have to ensure that the transaction that you want to execute from the multisig is a swap owner transaction where you exchange the access, and then we have to check that it was confirmed by the required amount of friends, and then we can actually execute this transaction. And this is just one example. There could be like lots of different kind of modules, lots of different kind of recovery mechanisms that people have in mind that could eventually work. So far, we have not found yet the silver bullet for recovery yet, But we think like the smart contract based wallet will be the foundation for this for sure, because it lays the foundation to have different sorts of access controls. Another thing that we are also innovating on is proxy contracts. So one of the downsides of using a smart contract based accounts is that creating those accounts and creating all those contracts can cost quite a lot. So with the current multisig, Gnosis multisig, it costs about, I think, 1 million gas to actually create another instance of this multisig. And this is because the bytecode for this multisig was deployed over and over again. Since one of the recent hard forks, we are able to actually implement full proxy contracts. And what a proxy contract essentially does, it implements only one function, the fallback function, which relays all the transactions sent to this contract to another contract, or like loads the logic of another contract and executes this logic within this proxy contract. So essentially, it behaves exactly like what we call the master copy, which in our case has all the logic that the safe implements. But it requires way less bytecode because the only function that's implemented in this proxy contract is this one single fallback function. And this allows us to create new safe contracts very efficiently. It costs just a few cents today to actually create a new multisig contract, and should allow basically anyone to use such a contract and not worry about gas costs. So let's sum up what are the advantages. We are able to create fine granular access schemes. What is currently implemented is just regular multisig and two-factor authentication is what we essentially use for our own clients. You can integrate all kind of new access schemes like recovery options or daily limit transactions. You can pay transaction fees now, not only in Ether, but you can use any ERC20 token. And you can also improve UX on your own DApps by using batch transactions. And there are probably many more advantages if you think about like all kind of different modules that you may want to do. So are there any disadvantages? Surely there are. So execution costs are slightly increased because now you have the overhead of sending meta transactions, having to check more signatures eventually if you require more signatures to be validated. So this all adds up, but it's not very significant. The biggest disadvantage that people so far saw is that if you are using such a contract account, you are adding a new attack surface because you have this additional code in between. And because this code manages everything that you have, it is very important, obviously. And well, in the past, we saw that this trust was not always justified. So what did we do in order to make sure that our code is actually trustworthy? We did formal verification of our contracts. So that's... what we did is we started, basically the discussion started already last DEF CON in Cancun, where Phil Dayan was asking us if we want to do formal verification together with runtime verification, because this contract, in his point of view, was as important as the Casper contract. So we started talking to runtime verification, and fortunately, thanks also to the Ethereum Community Fund and the Gnosis Ecosystem Fund, we were able to fund the verification of our contracts. So what does formal verification actually mean for us? So what you have to do for formal verification is, first of all, you have to create a mathematical specification of what your contract's actually supposed to do. And this ensures two things, I would say. First of all, you are very clear about what your contract should actually be doing. And also, I think, in the future, for sure, it will lead also to a very simplified smart contract design. Simply because doing formal verification is a really, really time-consuming process. So right now, it's still not fully completed, but we expect it to be completed in maybe about like 2 weeks. But there are two developers working full-time on it, and it takes them about 2 months to get to completion for just one relatively simple contract. Yeah, so does it mean that the contract will never have any bug? No, probably not, but the big advantage is that we kind of did like an additional implementation of it and verified that we came to the same conclusions. So the likelihood that there are bugs in this contract drastically decreased. And it's kind of like the highest standard of security that we can provide today for smart contracts. Currently, doing formal verification is still a very time-consuming and costly process, but I think in the mid-term future, costs for this will go down so low that it will actually be as expensive as doing a regular manual audit. Today, we have already like several releases of our Android and now also of our iOS app. So actually, you can go to safe.gnosis.io and you can download the Android or iOS app on your phone. Currently, it's limited to Rinkeby, so please don't send your real Ether to those wallets yet. However, we are going to release mainnet versions in about 2 weeks when formal verification is completed. We don't want to go on mainnet without having this process been done. We also have a browser extension, and you can actually pair the mobile phone with the browser extension, which allows you to not only interact with the apps that are accessible on your desktop browser, but the browser extension can also serve as a two-factor authentication device. So you have one key in your browser extension and the other key on your phone, and you require both in order to send any transaction. So it's kind of the simplest possible way you can today set up a multisig for your personal use. We also want to get the developer community involved. So we have several bounties up on Gitcoin. Two bounties that I want to mention. So we were talking about about modules to extend the functionality of our wallet. And one very obvious module that we'd like to see is a daily limit module for ERC20 tokens. Basically, a user should be able to define, I'm okay with withdrawing $1,000 worth of tokens and Ether on a daily basis without the requirement of two-factor authentication. But if I want to go above this value, then I should always have to send or sign with two devices. So yeah, I think I'm not sure if these bounties are actually still available because people were signing up for them very quickly. But definitely check it out anyways. And we're going to publish more and more bounties. Yeah, that's basically already it. I think I may have time for like one question or two.
Yeah, we got time for a question.
Great presentation. How do you design for trust in the recovery module if your friends become adversaries and collude?
Yeah, so again, like we haven't really figured out the recovery problem yet, but what will most likely be a proper solution is to combine something that's called paralysis proof together with an additional authentication requirement. No. So paralysis proof would work like this, that you kind of have to prove that you don't have access to your wallet anymore by sending a transaction with a bond, let's say 100 Ether or less, and this bond can be slashed in case anyone can send a transaction from your multisig. But if no one can do this within a time frame that you define, let's say a month or so, then this is a very strong indicator that no one actually still has access to this multisig. So this could be one component of it, but it also has its flaw because if I know that you're going on vacation and you will not have internet for 1 month, then I could exploit the situation, I could send this transaction, and then I know because you will not be able to react to it, I can take over your account within this time frame. So ideally you would like to combine multiple solutions. I think this this paralysis proof works for sure if you wait for a very long time, let's say 1 year. But of course, the usability is really, really bad if you lose access to your account and you have to wait for 1 year. So ideally, we can combine it and make this time frame very much shorter if we, for example, allow friends to additionally combine this kind of proof together with social recovery. This should make it way less likely. Like if your friends basically have to first agree on that, okay, we're gonna try to steal your account, but first of all, we have to send $10,000 to this account, which will be slashed in case our friend is coming back from vacations earlier. Seems very unlikely. But yeah, we haven't figured it out yet. But we will try to come up with some specifications until the end of the year, and of course, would like to have feedback from the community.